Dear students, welcome to our class on ancient plant protection, the knowledge of plant protection in ancient times. We are going to learn in this class. Before I formally start our class, there is a quote to inspire you. There is no greatness where there is no simplicity. There is no greatness where there is no simplicity. Good. So let us go straight into our class. During the ancient times, the plant growth and development. In the modern times, you know, growth is defined as irreversible increase in the volume and size. Same things almost were available in our ancient times. Irreversible increase in the volume and size, of course, we call it as by definition growth in the crop sciences are concerned. Now, what our ancient knowledge says in the plant growth and development, one or two, three lines, you see, what we know it is indirectly known. If not technically as advanced as today, somewhere to some extent it is available. What is it? Vedas represent the most sacred literature of the Vedic Indo-Aryan. Okay, in that it was mentioned that the sun is the purifier and the protector of everything. Sun is the purifier and protector of everything. The light, in the light part of the spectrum, 0.4 to 0.6 microns is the light. You know, same thing was indirectly was mentioned in the Rig Vedas. What is it? The light feed all the living things. Light provides the whole energy. It is essential for germination and of course plant development. So this was available in Rig Veda times itself. Let us go. Some special treatments during or after the planting. What were available in the ancient time for growth and development? Some special treatments were given. Okay, again I am telling, modern scientific knowledge is essential. Okay, most essential. Innumerable scientists are spending an enormous amount of knowledge, time and everything, and then building vast knowledge. But however, let us try to understand what is traditionally available in the ancient time. Quickly, we just try to understand 1, 2, 3. What are those? Number one, if rose is grown near a peach tree, the fruits of the peach tree will be sweet smelling. Wonderful thing. Now, at the same time, okay, planting a vine cutting, if dung is applied on its lower part, it produces roots quickly and will remain safe from insects. Wonderful ancient knowledge on growth and development. If two or three eggs are bunged beneath each plant, it will produce more figs. Or if the sap of pounded leaves, you know, pounded leaves of olive, pounded means, you know, grinding, pounded leaves of olive, is sprinkled on a fig tree, it will grow more fig. Cold water should be avoided for irrigating the rice fields. In pomegranate, the branches of upper are good for using for propagation. You should not cut them with any tool or implement. You should not cut. You should hand break it, then do it. These were the things, certain special treatment during or after the planting. Plant protection in the ancient time, it was a wonderful knowledge. For example, some of the pest affecting crops were named in Sanskrit, Gandhi. Okay, apanti odor smell. Now it is almost close to, okay, what we call it as the Gandhi bug. Shankhi, of course, Shankhi is again snails. Pandarmundi, okay, means white head, is a typical symptom of rice stem borer. So these were many. As far as plant protection is concerned, similarly, dhuli means powdery mildew, of course, on wheat and barley. Shringari means, you know, it is something close to rust diseases. These are all the diseases that were mentioned in the ancient literature. Besides that, you know, of course, insects and diseases, it was also mentioned that goats, deer, rats, wild boars, pigs, and sometimes even sparrows were recorded as to some extent destroyers of crops. This was mentioned in the literature. Okay, now plant protection in ancient India, they used to protect plants. Of course, the wonderful knowledge is available for the plant protection of it is innumerable scientists, innumerable companies, corporations, they are developing wonderful insecticides, water combinations and everything. So at that time in the ancient India, when these were not available, what they used to do, certain things what were available with them. Biotic and abiotic disasters are seen, just like our human beings and animals, they were observing, you know, these things on the plants as well. Man can speak, okay, whereas plants cannot speak. So they have developed some association with the plant, and they try to understand that biotic and abiotic stresses are very much there on the at that time itself. Hautilia was the first to suggest the use of seed dressers. Hautilia himself had suggested what else is required, and of course a Buddhist document mentioned mildew of paddy and blight of sugarcane. Okay, so innumerable things were available like that. In Arthashastra it was mentioned that organic materials were used to control crop disorders. For example, cut ends of sugarcane, what we call it, the sets of sugarcane, S-E-T-T-S, sets of sugarcane. At that time, cut ends of sugarcane, okay, meant for planting, were plastered with a mixture of honey, ghee, the fat of hogs, and cow dung. What for? Protecting. Protecting from soil borne. Of course, several, okay, protection are required at that time in the absence of modern knowledge. Similarly, okay, neem leaves were commonly used to control storage pests at that time. Now, so plant protection in Vriksha Ayurveda. Plant protection in Vriksha Ayurveda. See, Vriksha Ayurveda. What else? That was the knowledge to protect our crops and plants. What was mentioned there? Swarupala has given plant protection techniques in a very systematic manner, in a very, very systematic manner, right from the seed treatment to the storage of grain. Seed treatment, before we sow the seed, after we sow the seed, it comes emergence, seed germination emergence. From that systematically, Swarupala had given in the Vriksha Ayurveda. Now, what are those? Some one or two, three of them, let us see. The diseases of Pitta occur at the end of the summer if trees are excessively watered with materials, okay, which are bitter, sour, salty, and strong. The diseases of kapha type occur in winter and spring if trees are excessively watered with materials which are sweet, oily, sour, or cold. Like that, you know, wonderful mentioning was there in a systematic way in Vriksha Ayurveda. Similarly, ancient plant protection practices still followed. Ancient plant protection practices still followed. Just in four locations I did. But in the Asian Agri History Foundation, okay, innumerable are there. Only to inspire you, to give you some knowledge, I have just started only four. In the four also, one or two I try to explain. You can refer those books of Asian Agri History Foundation for better knowledge. Simple things I will mention: plant protection in Arunachal Pradesh. Several things are there. I would like to give only one or two. Farmers, okay, use buttermilk for controlling the pests. Farmers treat garlic seeds with buttermilk, 10 to 12 liters per hectare, before sowing for protection against different diseases and insects. Even today it is being followed. Asafoetida, to control ergot sorghum, they use it. To control tomato wilt, they use turmeric powder, 15 to 20 grams, okay. Control of early stem borer in sugarcane, okay. So they use some sort of control by using neem leaves or neem related products. Similarly, control of termites, control of storage pests, you know, they have wonderful knowledge as far as that particular area is concerned. Similarly, plant protection in Rajasthan, okay, they do, even today, they do control termites. How? Termite attack and cracking up epidermis in fruits can be avoided by using a paste on the main trunk with a mixture of mustard oil 1 liter, turmeric powder 200 grams. Okay, by doing this, you know, they were able to control the termite. For control of Helicobacter, farmers amend the soil with a pre-incubated mixture of oak leaves 5 bags, neem kernels and leaves 95 bags, and asafoetida 200 grams to check the termite attack in the field and soil borne diseases. Farmers use as far as this thing is concerned. Similarly, control of thrips, aphids, whitefly, and other diseases. They have good knowledge. Similarly, plant protection in Rajasthan is concerned. In paddy, a solution of 4 liters of cow dung urine, okay, cow dung urine, otherwise you know urine itself, or cow urine itself, 10 grams of asafoetida in 10 liters of water is paid to repel sucking pest. Similarly, blast on paddy can be controlled by, okay, mixing 3 kgs of cow dung, 3 liters of water, like that, you know, damping off and dying also, they are able to do it. Similarly, plant protection in tea estates in Northeast India. Recently, based on Propolis Vriksha Ayurveda, of course, certain thing, you know, Panchagavya, like that, you know, you are nowadays seeing all these terms for tea plantations, you know, okay, in the Northern India, they were doing it. Control of tea mosquito bug, this is a problem. I had an opportunity to see the tea mosquito bug to some extent, you know, it is a serious problem there. I had an opportunity to go and learn from their books also. What is it? That one only I mentioned here, in addition to the knowledge I gained from Asian Agri History Foundation. What is that? The method followed in certain tea estates is very wonderful to note. Please understand what is it. Fresh leaves of, okay, certain fresh leaves are chopped, okay, of certain plant into a small pieces and filled up to the brim in a 200 liter barrel. In a 200 liter barrel like this, you know, I had an opportunity to see, that's why I mentioned here, 200 liters of barrel, they do it. Then raw cow dung 20 kg, molasses 2 kg are added to it, and barrel is filled with water up to the top and stirred up well. So it is stirred up, it is kept in the tea estate. Then the barrel is closed with a lid, of course, for to avoid certain unwanted things to come and then enter. They avoid it and allowed to ferment for 12 to 15 days. It is filtered and used in desired concentration as decoction. Okay, in desired concentration, they do it. Why I am saying that, when I had seen it, they do it very early in the morning, before 7 or 8 o'clock, before sun actually rises and heat increases or temperature increases. They do it because of certain local traditional norms with their knowledge. In addition to that, this decoction is found very effective against, of course, Caryophyllis at all concentration. Spraying at weekly intervals at 2% concentration controlled this dreaded pest in tea plantations. This impressed me a lot, that I had given here. What all we tried to understand in this class are very, very simple ancient plant protection. Before that, first, what is plant growth and development? In modern crop physiology or plant physiology, growth is irreversible increase in the volume and size. From there, we started our learning in this class. So, plant growth and development, what were the things that were done before and after planting of anything? We had done, we have tried to understand some plant protection measures, plant protection in ancient India, plant protection with reference to or according to Vriksha Ayurveda, Swarupala's systematic way, how he had given some examples of plant protection in Arunachal Pradesh, some examples of plant protection in the semi-arid region of Rajasthan, some plant protection by tribal farmers in Rajasthan, plant protection in tea estates. What I impressed me during my visit, we tried to understand. If you want more literature, as I said, you can go to Asian Agri History Foundation books and you'll learn it. Thank you very much for your patience in learning it. Before I end the class, once again, I would like to give the quote of our class, you know, there is no greatness where there is no simplicity. There is no greatness where there is no simplicity. Thanking you very much. May God bless you.